The BPR Championship, or FIA GT Championship how it was called later, brought us some crazy cars. Homologation rules meant that the teams had to build copies of their racing cars for road use. But while a good number of these cars could pass at least as hypercars, some of the other teams went just crazy. And the team that pushed the regulation to the limits was without a doubt Toyota with the GT1. So hello guys and welcome back to another video. And here is the story of Toyota GT1, the road legal spaceship. The Toyota name was part of Group C from the beginning. Originally it was Tom's team that would enter a number of different Toyota powered cars. In 1982 they entered with a modified Celica, and later with a number of prototype cars, with the 82, 83, 84, 85 and 86C. Toyota would only enter the championship officially in 1987, with the 87C. Which, like the name suggests, was the successor of the Tom's car. Toyota would continue to use basically the same car also in 1988 with the 88C. But also in 1988 they would introduce a new car, and this was the 88CV. And this car was on another level. All the previous cars were powered by 4 cylinders, while the CV was powered by a 3.2 liter twin turbo V8. The numbers that this engine, called R32V, produced were just crazy. More than 800 horsepower at 8000 rpm, and with a curb weight of 850 kilos, the 88CV could reach a top speed of over 370 kilometers per hour. For the 1990 season, the engine was increased to 3.6 liters. This version could easily top 1000 horsepower. The cars powered by this engine were used until 1992, when FIA decided to apply new rules in order to stop this madness. The rules stated that the teams had to use 3.5 liter naturally aspirated engines. And like most of the teams, Toyota went for a V10. The car, named TCO10, was totally new, and was built in collaboration with TWR, which helped many teams in Group C and GT1. With the case of Group C in 1994, Toyota decided to focus more on JGTC and WRC, when they would become quite successful. But in 1995, Toyota decided to return to the international endurance scene. The newly formed BPR Championship was appealing to many manufacturers, thanks to the freedom that the teams had. Like Nissan, Toyota decided to enter with a tuned version of their top car, the Supra. But like Nissan, the car was so heavily modified that it was classified as a GT1 car. So Supra had to go against some truly crazy cars, including here another Toyota-based car, the MC8R of SARD. This car was just crazy. The car was based on the second gen MR2, but it was completely redone. The engine was based on the 4 liter 1UZ FE. This engine was the flagship engine of Toyota back then and was mostly used on Lexus. But both cars failed to achieve success. Understanding that winning against cars like CLK GTR, Porsche 911 GT1 and McLaren F1 was impossible with production-based cars, No matter how fast and powerful they were, Toyota decided to build a new car from the ground up. And Toyota had to exploit every loophole in order to win. And they really pushed the rules to the limits. The development of the car was assigned to Toyota Team Euro in Cologne, Germany, and Dallara in Italy. This European branch was founded in the mid-70s and had been responsible for the rally cars of Toyota, and by the mid-90s they had also started tuning road cars. The original BPR rules stated that the teams had to build at least 25 homologation cars in order to qualify for the GT1 class, while the prototype class was made out of Spiders, which most of the time were ex-Group C cars which had lost their roof. But for the 97 season, rules changed and the team had to build only one homologated version, something that allowed the teams to go crazy. The work started in January 97 and the team worked mostly on the body. The design was the most aggressive that GT1 class had seen until then. The GT1 looked more like a prototype Group C, with the short and wedged shaped nose and the long rear end, and the giant wing. The GT1 was also the first GT1 car to feature a front diffuser. For the engine, Toyota decided to go back to the R36V, with 600 horsepower at 6000 RPM and 480 pound-foot of torque at 6000 RPM, of course limited. By the end of September, the car was ready, but before that, the car had to pass the homologation test of FIA. And one of the most interesting rules of the championship was that both cars, the road and the race car, had to have enough space for a suitcase. Mercedes had found one of the most unique solutions by putting the suitcase on the door sills, but the solution of Toyota was way more interesting and at the same time much simpler. They just claimed that the fuel tank could also be used as a trunk when it was empty, and thanks to the vague regulations of GT1 class, they passed the test. While for the interior, they put two leather seats and a different dashboard, and that was all. Toyota built two road versions of the GT1. One was sent to Automobile Club de la Quest, or SCO, to pass the homologation test, and later was sent to Japan, while the second one never left the garage of Team Euro. And so Toyota was ready for Le Mans 98. '98 saw a new lineup of cars. Nissan presented the brand new R390, Porsche the 911 GT1 98, and Mercedes the CLK LM, which used the new M119 V8 instead of the M120 V12 that the CLK had used until then. Toyota entered three cars, and during the week the cars were showing great results, qualifying in 2nd, 7th and 8th place. But things didn't go as planned on the race day. One of the cars had to leave the race due to an accident, while the two remaining cars had a tough fight with the 911s. However, during the last laps, a second Toyota had to retire due to gearbox failure, and so the only Toyota that finished the race only managed to get the 9th place overall and 8th on the GT1 class. Understanding that there were too many loopholes in the regulations, FIA and ACO decided to change the rules, requiring a large amount of homologation versions for the GT class. By doing this, they basically eliminated the GT1 class, turning it into a prototype class with no homologation requirements. This meant that the teams had to build new cars that would comply with these new rules. but these rule changes were so drastic that most of the teams decided to leave, including here Porsche, Nissan and Panos, which had been the dominating force of the Le Mans last year. Mercedes and Toyota were the only ones that stayed, and also Audi joined them with the R8C, which was the hardtop version of the R8R. Mercedes had to build a new car, which came under the name CLR. The CLR was almost a complete different car from the CLK, and also a complete disaster. But that's a story for another time. Meanwhile, Toyota changed nothing. The GT1 was so extreme that they qualified for the regulations of the new class. And with less competition, the 1999 Le Mans looked like it was the year of Toyota. Again, like in 98, they proved extremely fast on qualifiers, taking 1st, 2nd and 8th place. The 1990 Le Mans was a total disaster for many teams. First was Mercedes, which would suffer a lot by the extreme aerodynamics of the CLR. The Mercedes would have 3 major accidents, 2 involving Mark Webber during the qualifiers and the warm-up. But like I said, that's a story for another time. Toyota started the race pretty good, but this wouldn't last for long. Pretty soon, Toyota would lose its first car due to a tire puncture that led to a high-speed accident involving the car of Martin Brundle. Halfway into the race, another GT1 was lost, and again in a tire puncture that led to a high-speed accident, this time destroying the car of Thierry Boutsen. With only one car and with the rest of the LMP GT cars out of the race, Toyota had to give everything in order to win. And the hardest competition came from BMW, which had dominated most of the race with their BMW V12 LMR prototype. But when it looked like Okio Katayama was ready to take the lead, another tire blowout befell Toyota. Katayama was able to return to the pits for a new set of tires and managed to continue the race. But by then, the race was basically over. Toyota managed to finish the race on the 2nd place, followed by the Audi R8R. They managed to finish 1st on the LMP GT class, but they were the only one that finished the race. So that basically didn't mean much. The 99 Le Mans would be the last for many manufacturers. With new changes, most of the teams decided to focus on other things. And so did Toyota, which decided to enter into F1 for in the new millennium. Toyota would return to Le Mans only in 2012 after leaving F1. And after many tries, they would finally win Le Mans in 2018, after both Porsche and Audi decided to retire from the LMP1 class. Now looks like Toyota is also going to be part of the new hypercar class, another extreme road racer. So guys, thank you for watching and see you next time.